So able to see my screen, right? So I'm going to start Advantage online shopping application today. And these are the three scripts that I'm going to cover. So apart from this, like, you know, you can try user registration. User registration, you all did it, right? With other applications, you know, please, you know, do it yourself. Please do that user registration yourself with Advantage online shopping application. So I will be covering this one, browse all laptops, order first laptop and order random laptop. Okay. So browse all laptops, you know, let me show you that, you know, what all steps we have in that, you know, in that script, we will be having in that script. So once you go to advantageonlineshopping.com, right? So you go to laptops page, right? And there are around, like, you know, 11 laptops over here, right? There are 11 laptops over here. So what you have to do is, like, you know, browse all laptop means you should go to each page, right? So next, again, go to laptops like this. So basically you have to browse through all the laptops and, you know, capture the, measure the response time of each page. Is it clear, guys? Guys, are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
You got it, right? So, you know, you should browse through all the products available. Okay. And right now, 11 products are available. So tomorrow, if some more laptops are added or some laptops are removed, also your script should work. Got it? Guys, user registration you will do, right? User registration you can do, right? So, you know, you already did that with, you know, web tools application and, you know, JPET store, I think, right?
Yes, sir.
So try user registration yourself. Okay. So, you know, on the top, right, you have this user icon, right? Click on that and, you know, click on this, you get this window. So click this create new account, right? And fill all your details and, you know, do the script by your own. Because you already did that with, you know, web tools. Yes.
I think we have completed this user registration in AOS. Sir.
Yes.
With JMeter we have completed?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay, okay. Fine. So, you know, now next thing that you have to do is go to your laptop page and, you know, browse through all the laptops. That is the scenario what I explained here. Browse all laptops means I will add the steps, you know, I'll add a sheet and I'll add the steps further. All right. But, you know, that is the whole. That is the thing that we are going to, that is a script that we are going to work on today. Yeah. So now I will stop my screen share. You can share your screen now. Second. But maybe this is useful for everyone, right? So what is the, you know, what is the learning here?
Mistakes, spelling mistakes also we want to pinpoint.
Go to JMeter once. Whenever you are facing some issue, right, you know, you check the recording log. Compare with the recording log. Okay. So go to load the recording log and see it is, you know, something wrong with request number 63. We identified that something wrong with request number 63. Go to request number 63 and compare this. So you can simply, what you can do is copy this request, right? And go to text-compare.com, right? So hold on, let me open this. So go to text-compare.com and compare the, you know, request body in the recording log and replay log. Isn't it?
Yes, sir.
That will help you understand, right? I think you have set the proxy. Can you revert back that proxy?
Okay, sir.
Okay. So go to the script, you know, go to the, you know, replay log, right? And, you know, oh, I cleared the replay log, right? Go to the replay log, select that, you know. Okay, let me repeat, you know, what is the mistake? Hey, how come it is reverted? I added E, right?
Sir, I think we didn't save that thing, sir.
Okay, let me replay it just to show you, okay? Just for the recording purpose, you know. And you kept 15 iterations. See, first run the script for one iteration. Okay. Once it is successful, then only run for multiple iterations.
Okay, sir.
Right. So without, you know, without making sure that, you know, the script is running successfully, there is no point in running for, you know, more than one iteration, right?
Yes, sir.
So now, you know, we observed that, you know, like here, request number 63, something went wrong here, right? Go to the, you know, replay log and select that request under, that is under T4, right? So go to T4, select that request and copy that request body. Okay. You copy this request body and, you know, paste it in the, compare it with the recording log. Right. So it will highlight all the differences. See, CT is fine. So that can be there. And, you know, here also, see, both departure and arrival CT, yes, it may be, there may be some differences. And date also, that is fine. You'll see some differences in the data, right? So, and, you know, if you see the, is it, did it highlight that arrive?
No, it's not highlighted.
How come? So, where is that request seat preference?
Yeah.
ARR IVE. Yeah. Hey, here it is. It is highlighted here. See. Okay. After, you know, see, is equal to, before is equal to also, it have highlighted.
Yes,
observe,
sir.
Here. See, departure is equal to. This did not highlight till equal to. Okay. See, here it did not highlight. But, you know, this is, here it have highlighted. So, when you make some mistakes, right, you know, it will be difficult to, you know, debug that script, right? Anyways, like we found it easily. For e case like that, we found it easily. But sometimes, you know, if you do some mistakes, right, so now it will be difficult to debug, isn't it? So arrive is equal to the Greninchi, it did it. So in that case, what you can do, go to the replay log and check the, you know, HTML, isn't it? Go to the replay log and select HTML and see, you know, what response you got. Then I understood clearly. After seeing the HTML response, I understood clearly, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So now on seeing this page, I understood that, you know, that there is something issue with the arrival city. So actually what should be there here, flights departing from departure city to arrival city, there should be some city here, but instead of that, there is date here. Then I understood that there is some issue with that arrival city, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So, you know, then I saw the, you know, request body. What is the request? What is wrong with the request? There is something wrong with the request. Now I understand, seeing this, I understood that, you know, some, that E is missing, right? By mistake, he deleted that letter E in the arrival city. And, you know, like, just to confirm that, I checked the recording log. Okay. So he told that I did not make any change. Just to confirm that, I checked the recording log. Recording log, you'll have the same request, right? Go to the same request and see the request body. So now here I saw that, you know, I confirmed that there is, the string is, see, these are called as name value pairs. These are called as name value pairs. See the heading, column headers, name value. So that's why these are called as name value pairs. So then in the name value pairs, you know, the arrival city, it is, if I see the recording log, the arrival city is ARR IVE. The name is key value, name of the key value pair is arrive, right? Whereas here, you know, he missed that letter E. That's why that is the issue, that caused the issue. So that's how you have to debug, guys. You know, like if you see the request body and, you know, HTML request or HTML response, you'll find a clue. You'll understand what is the issue. Right. So if it is difficult to compare, right, line by line, you can use this text-compare.com always, isn't it?
Frankfurt to see.
Okay. Anything else, guys?
No, sir.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen. It's already 8:05. We will start the script then, right? So you start this AOS application. So, you know, I want to cover this one. So, you know, recently I attended one interview, like not recently, like around 3 months back, I attended one interview. you know, the question that one of the JMeter question that they asked is, what are the different controllers you used in JMeter? Okay, guys, give me a, you know, hold on. So loop controller is one another important, you know, controller that we use. And you know, after that you have for each controller, right? So I'm going to cover this for each controller. Okay, this is very important, you know, when you have to navigate through the pages. You know, let me give the context now. So let me show you. I already explained this one, right? Suppose, you know, if you have any web application like this, right? And you know, like there are some, you know, different products. Suppose you want to capture, like client want to see, like, you know, what are the response time of each page, like speaker space, tablet space, laptop space, my space, or else client want to capture, like, you know, if once they go to tablet, they have three products here. Client wants to see, like, you know, what is the response time of each page, right? If you click on each product, you will get a page, right? So if client wants to see, like, you know, what is the response time of each page, right? Then, you know, like for JMeter, you know, in JMeter, this for each controller will be very useful. So I am selecting laptops because it has more laptops, right? It has more products. This particular page has more products, right? So, you know, we will do with laptops. We will do the script with, you know, with the laptops. First, let us create, shall we create a manual template or shall we go with, you know, default one or a ready-made template?
Manual.
We'll go with manual template, okay? So click, go to file, click new, right? And by default, you know, test plan element will be added. Very important interview question. So what are the steps in recording a script? Or else, you know, how do you create a template, right? Or what are the different elements that are required for recording? Okay. What are the elements, different elements required for recording the JMeter script? Isn't it? Guys, yes or no?
Yes.
Okay. What are the elements required? So first, you know, by default, you will have a test plan element by default. To that test plan, we add a thread group. Yes. Next.
Transaction controller.
Yeah. So thread group is nothing but a script, right? So, you know, what we can do here is we can give some name here. You give the, you know, at AOS at for, you know, application name, your application name. And, you know, this is, you know, what script is this?
Browse all laptops page.
Okay.
At this, you don't have login or something.
No, you'll have that. So I'm giving the thread name like that. So you will have that.
Okay. Yeah.
So under that thread group, you add different transaction controllers. Copy this and, you know, paste over this.
Yes.
So what would be the steps here? So in this step, not required actually. Login not actually required. So once you go to homepage, you need not to log in for, you know, browsing through the laptops. Only when you want to place an order, then you need to log in. That is mandatory to log in, right? So what is the first one? What is the first
homepage?
AOS, you know, homepage. Okay, or else, you know, let me see, browse laptops, okay? Let me see, I'll give the name as, or, you know, T01 homepage, right? Homepage or, you know, index page, you can give any name, right? What next? Copy the name, you know, copy till here, okay? So, what next?
Click laptops.
Yes, go to laptops page, okay? Go to laptops page and then 03, yes. Select each laptop or browse each laptop, right? Browse each laptop, right? So, you know, let's see, like if required, we will add some more transactions, okay? Now, you know, because I am going to put this in a for each controller in a loop, okay? So that's why, you know, I don't require, you know, for the next steps. If required, we will add that it be. So once we add, you know, the transaction controllers, then next element required for recording is, yes?
Listener.
Non-testable.
Non-testable. So test listener should be added to the thread group, not at the test plan, right? So add listener called view results tree. We will name it as, you know, replay log. Yes. And one important element for recording is
non-test element
called HTTP test script recorder. And again, to this test script recorder, add a listener called view results tree. I'll name this as recording log, right? And, you know, create one XML file, right? So go to your JMeter folder. So go to your JMeter folder and create, you know, one folder for this. Go to bin folder and create one. Let's see if I have a folder already. Yeah, I already have a, you know, folder for this. Now what I will do is for this script, I will create a new folder, okay? Browse all laptops. Okay. So under this folder, I will create a new file.
Yes.
Browse all laptops, you know, like I will create, you know, it says recording log. Recording log dot XML. Yes. Right? And rename this. Select rename. And, you know, copy the name, right? Or else, you know, you can click on browse and, you know, click on browse and go to that folder, go to bin folder, go to AOS, browse all laptops, you know, select the file, right? So what is the reason for this error? What is the reason for this error, guys? This is an error message, right?
There is no any files in the file.
It's an empty file.
Empty file. Yes. We are trying to load an empty file. That's why you get this error. You can ignore this. If you want to see, you know, if you go to the log file, right, it will clearly show you that it is an empty file.
Yeah, last line.
See here. Browse all laptops, recording log.xml is empty. That's why you are seeing that, you know. Okay, it's warning message, it says. Okay, that's why you are seeing that warning. Here you see the, you know, the error type, what type, whether it is an error or warning or info, you see that here, right? So it's a warning as per this log, it is a warning, right? So that warning came up because, you know, we are, that is an empty file, isn't it? Let me clear the complete log, okay? Now what next? Go to the, you know, like test script recorder, go to request filtering. So we need to sort out, you know, we need to filter out all the unwanted URLs, right? So let me first save this file in the folder, right? In the same folder, you know, let me save this script first. AOS browse all laptops. I save the script first, you know, and then we want that, you know, regular expressions to filter out the unwanted URLs, right? All the browser related URLs. For that, I know you can use the template, you know, you need not bother about, you know, creating all of those, right? So you can go to templates. Yes. Go to recording template. Select the recording template, create. And, you know, go to the test script recorder and, you know, copy from here, right? You can copy it from here. Or else, even though those who are lazy to create a new template, you can use the ready-made template, okay? Right? So now, you know, come to this, you know, request filtering tab and, you know, click this add from clipboard. Once you copy there, right? Once you copy here, simply use add from clipboard. All the regular expressions will be copied to here, isn't it? Right, and save the script once. So what next, you know, like the replay log, you know, we need not create a XML file. CSV file is enough. But make sure that for recording log, right, once you add a recording log manually, right, click on configure and, you know, this is important, guys. Okay, by default, save as XML will not be selected. This is important, guys. Okay. You got it? When you use a manual template, right? You know, you have to select all this manually and, you know, save it and make sure that it is saved. Sometimes it doesn't get saved. Okay, you may have to do a second time. So make sure that that is saved. Is it clear? Now what are the steps now? So we added a thread group and we added a non-test element called test script recorder. And you know, like we configured an XML file to save the recording log, right? And what next? And we also added one listener, vResults tree listener for as a replay log, right? And we added the transaction names. Next, what next?
Proxy.
Yes. So set the proxy.
What about cache manager and cookie manager?
Yeah.
Are they required for recording?
No. It will use for when
we replay the replay like. Only those are required.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So here not required. Okay. So you know, like for recording, those are not required, isn't it? Is it clear, guys?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now you know, like coming to so recording before recording, starting recording. So check the you know port number. Right. By default, the port number will be 48. To set JMeter as a proxy. See, remember you had to explain this stuff. To set JMeter as a proxy between your browser and server, you have to go to browser and you know change the proxy settings. Right? By default, no proxy will be there. See, it would be very good if you explain this. By default, no proxy will be selected. We have to select manual proxy configuration and give the same port number, right? So 48 in the browser that we are going to use for recording. Right, so you have to explain in this way. Okay, once the proxy is set, one more thing is that if the application is a HTTPS application, see, observe what is this? Is it HTTP or HTTPS? This is not HTTP. In at least in Firefox, it is not HTTP. Right. So it is saying clearly here connection is not secure. So this is a normal HTTP application only. But if it is an HTTPS application. You have to,
root CA certificate.
You have to import the JMeter's root CA certificate. So tell this clearly, JMeter's root CA certificate should be imported to the browser, isn't it? Yes.
Sir.
How to import that certificate? So you go to settings and type certificates here. View certificates, right? You have to click on this import button. Right now it is already there. Let me see. If you want to see the details, right, you know, select that certificate and click on view. It will show you the, you know, validity date and all. So it has, see, observe here, you know, this has expired. Already, you know, we are past this 26th July, right? So we have this, the certificate is no longer valid. What should we do now? So, you know, just remove this certificate, select this and, you know, click this delete or distrust, right? Make sure that, you know, like you are selecting JMeter certificate only. Otherwise, if you delete some other certificates, right? So your browser may not, you know, your browser functionality may be affected. Make sure that you are deleting JMeter certificate only. Okay. Don't delete any other certificates. Take care of that, right? So select the JMeter root CA certificate. You know, I observed that, you know, this certificate is expired, right? So for, you know, how to delete that in this case, use this delete or distrust, right? And it will ask for a confirmation. Check the certificate here also, right? Whether it is JMeter certificate or not, right? And click OK. Now it is deleted. Suppose you want to import, this is for HTTPS only, of course, right? This step is required only for HTTPS applications, isn't it? Not required for this, you know, but just to show you, I am doing this. Even though, you know, you do also import also, that doesn't cause any issue. See, this is a HTTP application, not required. But if you do also, that doesn't cause any issue. There is no harm in that, right? And now, you know, click on that import button to import the certificate, root CA certificate. See, observe here, Apache JMeter temporary root CA, right? Remember this name, you have to pronounce that as, you know, root CA certificate, JMeter's root CA certificate. Okay. And, you know, select these both checkboxes and click OK. And then say OK here. You should see that certificate now. Okay. Now you can see the certificate, right? So, and you can see the expiry date also. If you click on view, you can see the Hey, what is this? Okay. So see here, 2nd August. Can you tell me why you are seeing 2nd August now?
It's valid only for 7 days, I think.
Oh, that's fine, 7 days only. But I know.
Because imported just previous, now. Previous valid is 20.
Right, that is a certificate that was created long back. Okay. Let me show you that. That was created, sir. That certificate was created long back. So what you had to do to create a new certificate, what you had to do?
Go to
JMeter and, you know, start recording. You have to start recording, then a new certificate will be created. Let me show you that. So first let me show you when this certificate is created. See, this was created on 26th July, right? You can see the date modified, right? It was created on 26th July. Now, if you start recording in anything, right, you know, in any JMeter instance, right, that will be created. Now, you know, it shows like, you know, it is created, right? Stop recording. And, you know, you can see that date modified now. Let's check that. See, now, you know, you can see that it was created just now, 9th August, right? Now, import this certificate, right? Let me remove this. Let me, you know, delete this, right? And, you know, import the new one. Click on import. And, you know, when you are importing, check the date. Okay. Check the date when it was created. Right. Okay. Now let's see the date now. Click on view and see the date. Right. Now you can see this is valid from 9th August to 16th August. Right. So this is the last one in record. I mean, this is one more important thing for HTTPS applications. You have to import root CA certificate, right? That is one more important step, right? Now, once you do that, right? So you click on start record, select the target controller, isn't it? Select the target controller and start recording. So you have to cover all these steps. If you explain in that way, like, you know, it would be really good. That is a proper appropriate answer. Like, you know, if they ask, like, you know, what are the steps in recording a JMeter script? Got it?
Yes, sir.
Right. Select the target controller, right? You know, and, you know, click on start recording and, you know, go ahead, proceed with your recording. The next question would be, yeah, once you record the script, what are the next steps? Okay. We'll come to that. We'll discuss that later. So let me do this. So once I change the proxy, right, you know, once I started recording, right, you know, like you can simply refresh the request here, right? And make sure that, you know, it is recording, JMeter is recording, as well as, hey, one more thing, use, you know, incognito browser, okay? Because, you know, some unwanted URLs are getting recorded if you use a normal browser, right? Let's see. Here I don't see any, you know, third party URLs. That is fine. We'll go ahead. But, you know, remember, you know, to use, you know, incognito browser. Sometimes, you know, some applications like browser related requests get recorded, right? So this is done. And one more thing is, you know, make sure that, you know, it is recording. JMeter is recording the, capturing the, you know, request, right? Under appropriate transaction controller. And, you know, what is the next step now? Go to laptop space, right? Click on this laptop space, right? And also make sure that, you know, recording log is getting generated or not. Okay. Of course, this gets generated, you know, it doesn't cause an issue, right? But make sure that, you know, like, because suppose if you miss this, right? So suppose this is not saved, right? Right? So here it will record, but, you know, it will not be saved as an XML file. Means XML file, this one, right? So XML file will not be generated. XML file will not be generated, or, you know, they will not get saved in the XML file. If this checkbox is not selected, or if it is not saved, right? So what is next? So we are done with the second step, you know, browse, go to laptop space. We are done with that, right? What is the next step now? See here, some browser, browser related URL got recorded, incoming.telemetry.mozilla.org. right? So to avoid these, you know, such kind of browser related, you know, request, you know, use incognito browser, private browser, right? What is the next step now? Browse each laptop, right? Browse the laptop, each laptop, right? So I have 11 products here. I'll go to the first one, right? You need not record all the, you know, you need not record all the pages. You need not go to each page and record that. I'll show you, you know, we are going to use for each controller. So you need not, you know, repeat all the steps, right? So, you know, this is also recorded. Browse each laptop. This is recorded. Okay. I'll stop recording. We can stop recording now. We need not, you know, go to all the, you know, go to all the, we need not go to each laptop page, right? So I can stop recording. Right. Go to test script recorder and you can click on stop here and save the script once. Right. Let me remove this. All right. Now let's see, you know, how to use for each controller to, you know, to now browse all the pages, to browse each of each laptop page. Right. Let's see how to use that. Can we move ahead or any queries, guys?
Sir, it's good to go.
Huh? Yes, Manoj?
Good to go, sir.
What is that?
Good to go. Good to go ahead.
Okay, sorry. Yeah. So, you know, now let's see how to, you know, how to use for each controller to navigate through all the pages. First, see, you know, what are the dynamic, if there are any dynamic values. Let's go to the home page. And, you know, see the request, right? So this is the main URL, advantageonlineshopping.com, right? This is the main URL, which is a get request, right? Which is a get request, right? So let me revert the proxy here. This is the main URL, right? The first one. This is the main URL. And then you have some, these are related to images. What is this file, guys? SVG? What is this?
Image extension.
Yes. So this is nothing but an image, guys. Okay. Some scalable vector graphics or something. Okay. Right, scalable vector graphics. So this is nothing but an image. Okay, define SVG defines the graphics in XML format, or you know, it is a XML based vector image format. Okay, this is an XML extensible markup language is XML, right? XML based vector image format. This is one type of image format, right? So let's see, you know, like let's go to each request and, you know, see like if there are any dynamic values, you know, or if there are any unwanted URLs, right? Let's see if there are any unwanted URLs which are related to the browser, right? We don't have any, you know, see, observe here, we have, you know, headphones, laptops, tablets, mics. So we are seeing all the four product different categories, right? Speakers, tablets, laptops, mice, and one more, I think it will be there. No? Yeah. So headphones. Yeah. So you have five products here, right? Speakers, tablets, headphones, you know, laptops, mice. Five product categories, right? That's why you see this, you know, this one. Headphones, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? You have the five different product categories. And then what is this? This is savebrowsing.googleapis. You can toggle that, you can disable that request. This is related to your, you know, Google APIs. This is related to Google APIs, right? And next, let's go to the next request. So what is this one? So categories one, products, okay? And categories attributes, category page, fetch image, Just checking, you know, if there are any unwanted URLs or if there are any dynamic values. I didn't see any dynamic values here. So if you want to confirm, just replay the script and see. You know, if there is dynamic value and if you did not handle that, obviously the script will fail, isn't it? Is able to follow? And let's see the next request also. If you observe the next request, right, you know, see here, this is where we click, we selected one laptop, right? See,
yes.
In this request, we selected one laptop. And observe here, you know, products 9, right? And, you know, like, that is one request, important request. And then categories all data, products, categories 1, products, product page.html, save browsing Google APS. You can toggle this one also. You can disable this. And observe here, when you click on the first laptop, right? You go to the first laptop. So you go to the laptops page and click on first laptop. See here, this is the URL. Products 9. So the first laptop number has some product ID. There is some number assigned to that, you know, first laptop, which is 9. Okay. So they're not starting from 1. You know, please understand that. So if you click the second one, here you see 10. Right? So you see, this is product number ID. The product ID is 7. Right? So, you know, you have till obviously from 1 to 11. You have from 1 to 11. Isn't it? Now, what we will do is, you know, first we will capture how many products are there. First of all, we will capture how many laptops are there in that page, because I want to repeat this, you know, for loop for each controller, you know, those many number of times. Now, let me show you the PPT, how for each controller works, right? A for each controller loops through the values of a set of related variables, right? I kept a screenshot here, you know, just to, you know, to refer quickly. If you forget it, you know, you can refer this quickly. And these are the important fields in for each controller. Observe here, after home page and laptops page, I added for each controller and I have kept this navigate to laptop page under that, right? And observe here, you know, these are the input variables, important one. So input where there are two important fields, guys. So once I answered this question, right, I used if controller, while controller, you know, loop controller and for each controller, I said that was my answer. Then the next question he asked is, what are the fields in for each controller? Okay. What are the important fields in for each controller? Means he is referring to these two. You got it? He's asking about these two. Which two? This one. This is one important variable or one important field, and this is another important field. So you have to give, you know, you should know what are these two fields, right? Let me explain that. Okay. So you know, like, once you use for each controller, right, it will automatically navigate through all the pages. Let me show you that, right? Let me add a for each controller, right? Or else, first let me capture the number of products, how many products are there. We'll capture that first and then I'll show you how to add that. For now, you understood, right? You know, you have to, this is nothing but a product ID, right? And there will be 11, as we have 11 products, 11 laptops here, the product IDs will be from, you know, 1 to 11. So let me show you. This is 8th product. They gave the numbering like that, okay? See, they gave the numbering like that. The last laptop they gave us number 8. You got it, guys? So this is product number 5. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Right? You understood, right? There are 11 products and, you know, if for each product they have given some number. So we have, this number is important for us, isn't it? Because only that number is getting passed here. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
That number is getting passed here, not the product name. Product name is not getting passed, but product ID is getting passed. So we will capture that. This product ID is important for us. So first let us capture, once you go to the laptops page, right? Let's capture that, you know, how many products are there, first of all, right? So this is the laptops page, T02. That is a laptop space. And you know, if you observe here, there is, so I want to know from where can I capture. First of all, you should know from where I can capture all the product IDs. For that, you simply go to recording log, right? And you know, once you go to laptop space, the products will be displayed, isn't it? Once you go to laptop space, the products are being displayed. All the 11 laptops are being displayed. So you go to that, you know, that, particular in the script, go to that laptops page and, you know, request number 34 to 44, they are related to the laptops page, right? go to the recording log and check now from 34 to 44, right? So 34, if you observe here, products, see, categories one products, go to the response data, right? And, you know, select HTML. See if you are seeing any HTML content. Right? You are not seeing any HTML content. You will not see images and all. You are not seeing. That's fine. But these are all the different laptops, right? Now, if you see here, if you go to this lab products, right? Or else, you know, let me do one thing. So, go to your application. And once you click on laptops, right? See what is the URL. Okay. See, category laptops one. Category laptops one is the page where we are seeing all the laptops, isn't it?
Yes.
Right. So let me show you. Let me check something. Yeah, category laptops one, right? So categories. Okay. There is a change in the URL. Categories one products anundi kada. Here it is something like that. Category page.html. Okay. Okay, it's difficult to interpret here, of course, right? So, you know, if you go to this categories one products, right, you know, see the request number 34 in the recording log. Okay, so this is request number 34, and here actually you can see all the laptops. Okay, all the laptops names you can see here. Okay, so or else, you know, like let me search for product ID. Will there be something called product ID? Yeah, so here it is. So there is something called product ID, and you know, you can see, basically you can see it is not showing HTML here. That is a problem. Otherwise you can easily understand that, you know, this is the page where we are seeing HTML, all the laptops. But if you see here, you know, like you can see all the model names. See, okay, I'll show you one way to figure out that. Okay, so what is the laptop, you know, name here? The first laptop, see, you can search for this laptop, right? And, you know, search for that laptop name here. Right? You can see the laptop, right? You can see the laptop model name here, right? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Right? And you see this product name, okay? Product name. Now search for this product name. You'll see all the laptops, different laptops, right? This is one. This is the first laptop, HP Pavilion Fume Touch Laptop. And next, HP Chromebook 14, right? So if you click on find, right, you know, you'll see all the products, all the laptops now, right? HP Chromebook 14 G1 and a ES, Energy Star. And this is HP Envy. So you are seeing all the laptops, basically, you are seeing all the laptops over here in this page, right? Now, what we want now in the next request, the product ID is getting passed, not the laptop model name, isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes,
the next request, when we browse each laptop, right, actually they are getting called with the product ID, right? So this number, we want this number. So search for that number. You know, search for that, you know. Hold on. So products 34. What is that?
Recording log. Enter.
So what you do is, you know, search for the first product, okay? So this is the first one. So this is the first laptop, right? That's what we recorded, right? While recording, that's what we selected. I'm searching for that laptop. Okay, so there is a space here. That's why you see that, you know, you could not find. Right? So this is the product name. This is nothing but your product name. And observe here, there is a product ID 9 here. The number 9 is here. Now what we do is, you know, like you can see, like, you know, how many copy this and search for that product ID. Okay. And keep on clicking, you know, that finding that. See, you see product ID 9. And next occurrence product ID 10. And then you have product ID 7. Right. You will see 11 occurrences. Okay. Or else, you know, let me do one thing. Copy that as left boundary. I want to, now I understood that, you know, I have to capture the product ID, isn't it? Guys. So this is my left boundary. This would be my left boundary. Right. So select boundary extractor tester. Right. Give it in left boundary and right boundary is a comma. Right. If you observe that, right boundary is a comma. Okay, or else let me show you that once. Okay. Response data. So if you copy the product ID, right? If you search for product ID, observe here. After product ID, there is a comma here. There is a comma here, this comma. I'm going to use this as right boundary. I want to confirm whether, you know, these are the left and right boundaries or not, right? So I copied the product ID here and comma here and, you know, do a click on this test. Now you can see it is showing 11 matches, right?
Yes,
yes.
It is clearly showing 11 matches. We have 11 laptops and, you know, that's why it is showing 11 matches. So I can use this as, you know, see for each row, there are 4 laptops, 4 plus 4, 8 plus 3, 11, right?
Yes.
So, the match count is also 11. That means, you know, these are the product IDs from 1 to 11, but, you know, they are not in a some order. They are not, yes, in sequential order, but they are, you know, random. They are in some random order, right? But, you know, here we can clearly see that, you know, the first product ID is 9, which we selected while recording. Now, what we will do is, you know, I will use this as left boundary and comma as right boundary to capture all the product IDs, right? So, first let me do that. Where are we getting that, you know? We got that in request number 34. Go to that particular request, add a boundary extractor. Yes, where boundary extractor will be there? Boundary extractor will be there under
post processor,
right? So go to post processor, add boundary extractor and keep the, you know, give that as left boundary, product ID as left boundary, and right boundary is nothing but a comma. And, you know, give some name to this variable. C underscore, what I will do is, you know, give, while giving the name, right, use the name that is given by developer. Okay. He used as product ID. Let us use the same thing. And, you know, I want to capture all the products now. Not just one, but I want to capture. See, tomorrow, you know, if they add some more laptops, right? Some more laptops, our script should not fail, right? So first, what I will do is, for that, I will capture all the laptops available now, today. And, you know, I will capture, for to capture all the laptops, right? I will give match number as minus. If you give match number as 1, what happens? If you give match number as 1, what happens?
It will capture
the product ID as 9, right? It will capture first occurrence, right? Which is nothing but 9. The first product ID is 9, isn't it? See, this is the first, yes, product ID, that is, yes, 9. Sir. So if you give 1, it will capture the first value. If you give 6, it will capture the 6th value, like that, right? If you give, yes, 0, it will capture 1 randomly, 1 value randomly, 1 product ID randomly. However, I want to capture all the product IDs, all the laptop models. So for that, you give minus 1. Okay.
Right? Why minus 1, Kishore? All means I'm not able to understand match number. Why minus 1? If random,
you want to capture, if you want to capture all the matchings, all the, you know, all the occurrences of this left and right boundary, then you can give minus 1 in JMeter. In loadrunner, we use ordinal is equal to all, right? So in the same, here we have to give minus 1. Match number as minus 1.
Okay.
In loadrunner, we give ordinal is equal to all, right?
Yes, yes.
So here in JMeter, we have to give match number as minus 1.
Okay. If you will have any logic reason of minus 1 in interview, if they are, why only minus?
No, JMeter Apache has designed in that way. Apache has defined in that way. Okay.
Okay.
Right. And, you know, give the name here so that, you know, you can see the name getting reflected here. right? On seeing the script, you will understand that there is some correlation here. And you know, here we captured all the product IDs, isn't it? Right? Now we know this will help us to capture all, right? And what is this default value? If this left and right boundaries are not found, right? Let me explain what is this default value. We did not use this default value till now, right? Yes. Let me explain what is this default value. Default value means, you know, if this left and right boundaries are not found, right? Then what it should display in the debug sampler, okay? So if you give here, you know, like the standard convention is people give like this most, right? So you like, you know, this, your correlation name, they give that correlation name underscore not found. Okay. This is some naming convention. Okay. Means first understand what is this default value. Default value means if this left and right boundaries are not found, then this will be displayed in the debug sampler. Okay. So let me add one debug sampler for this sampler. Let me add one debug sampler. Where is debug sampler?
Third one.
Right, so this will be displayed. You know, if it could not find that left and right boundaries, then this will be displayed in debug sample. Okay, now let me replay the script and you know, let me show you once. Right, let me clear this. Collapse the tree, select replay log, and let's check. You know, whether you know it captured all the. Let's see what is the size of that product ID array.
Now we are. C underscore product ID, we are not placed in replace.
I'll come to that. Select this generate parent sample so that you will see only the main transactions. Okay. Because this is, you know, this will be difficult to interpret, right? So select this generate parent sample for each transaction and replay the script one more time. Now you'll see only three transactions, that is home page, laptop page, and this one. Right? Yeah. Now see the debug sampler. Okay. So when you use this, you know, see, observe here. We'll come to this. Why it came not found here? See, observe here. It captured all the product IDs into an array, right? And see match number. What is this match number? That will tell you how many products are there. Means how many times this left and right boundary matched. That is what match. See, we gave some left and right boundaries, right? So what is this match number? Match number means how many times, you know, it found a match. And here you can see clearly that there are 11 matches and these are the different product IDs, right? 9, 5, 8, 10. So that is how they are, you know, they have given, right? See, after the first product ID is 9 and then second product ID is 10, right? Is it matching now? Okay. See, product ID, this is the, come on.
Yes.
Second one, wait. See, this is second one, product ID 2, this is 10, right?
Okay, 3 is 7, okay.
Yeah, so they have defined it that way. So let's not bother about that. But this is important for us, whether we got the match number or not, this is important. Right, we got all the 11 products, 11 product IDs captured, and these are the product IDs, isn't it? Now, why we got this is when you use this, you know, when you use this match number minus one, right? You will get like that. Okay, this is expected. That is not an issue. This is expected. You will see like, you know, default value will be this one only will be printed. When you use minus one only, suppose if I give, you know, let me give match number 5, and I want to capture the 5th product. Okay. Now you will not see that, you know, now let me replay and show you that, okay, clearly. So many people get confused here. Let me replay that and show you. See, observe here. That not found is not printed now, isn't it? Product ID, the product ID that it got captured is 1, right? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Fifth one, I gave match number as 5. So if you go to the recording log, right? Let me capture this, you know, left boundary, select text. Sorry. select text, response data.
See, fifth one. What is the fifth one? See, you know, let me search for that fifth one.
This is one, right? First occurrence, second occurrence, third, fourth, fifth. Right? Fifth one is the fifth product, product ID is one, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Right? That's what you are seeing here, right? That's what you are seeing here. Okay. You did not see that not found. Okay. Suppose if you know there is some problem with the your you know left boundary, instead of colon you give you know semicolon, right? Suppose so it could not find this, obviously it can't find this left boundary. Now let me show you what happens, right? Let me replay the script now. So you got it, right? Are you able to follow? I gave a wrong left boundary, so it could not found. Then it will display this one default value. Let me show you that. In the debug sampler, you will see that, you know, not found. Let me show you that, because I know I gave a, it could not find that left boundary. Yes. Now see here, displays the default value. Now you, did you understand what is the purpose of this default value, guys?
Yes. Yes.
Default value means if the left and right boundaries are not there in the response, right? Then it will be by default, it will display this, this, you know, whatever string you give here. It will display that thing, clear? But when you use minus one, when you are capturing all the values, right, you know, as it is an array, right, also, you know, it will not, you know, even though it found the matches, it will display this one. Because this is an array, basically, because this is an array. Is it clear, guys? No confusion,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Hope there is no confusion. Minus one pettinappudu, when you do match number as minus one, you will get this value. Don't worry about that. Just ignore that. Or else, you know, you need not give, you know, leave it. Otherwise, leave it. Skip this. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Right? Better not to give this. Okay. Just to avoid any confusion. Now, you know, let's go to this. Right? You see this?
Sir, left boundary change LS.
Yeah, sorry. So, correct left boundary is colon. Right? And you know, and one more thing, what is the purpose of this one? Use empty default value means a space will be, you know, printed in the, instead of that. Okay, let me show you that. Let me replay and show you that. A space will be printed if you use that, you know, use empty default value if you select this one. So, right, see here, in a space will be printed. Because we give empty default value. Use empty default value on them. That's why, you know, like it will show like this. But, you know, this is important for us. You know, we got all the match numbers, you know, then and the number of products are 11. Now let's move ahead. So we captured that, you know, this is the purpose of these two guys, default value, empty default value, right? When you are using minus one, when you are capturing all matches, all products, right, you know, no need to give this, specify this, right? Now let's move. Is it clear, guys? Or any confusion over there?
Yes.
Right. Now, you know, like all the products are there in the product ID array. In this one, you know, I have all the products in the product ID array. How can I say that? See here, I can say, I can clearly see here. My array name is this one. And in the first position, you have 9. Second position, you have 10 and so on. Isn't it? Right now, you know, like what I will do is I will use this product ID, I will use this, you know, variable, JMeter variable to repeat this loop. Browse each laptop step is there, right? I will repeat this, you know, I have to repeat how many occurrences are there? There are 11 match numbers. So I have to repeat this request 11 times while changing the value. E value product ID changes to, I have to repeat this loop for 11 times, isn't it? Is it clear or no, guys?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
okay. Now, how can I do that? I can simply use, you know, for each controller for that, okay? Now, let me add a for each controller to the script. Add, yes, logic controller, for each controller, right? And, you know, it should be there, you know, after once I go to laptop stage, I know I have to keep a for each controller loop, right? And I will keep this, you know, under this for each controller, right? Browse is laptop step, I kept under for each controller. Now let us see what are the fields for this. Input variable prefix. What is the input variable for this? Our input variable is nothing but, you know, like this one. This product ID array, this one. Okay, I copied this. And you have to give this as your input variable. Here. Means I have to pass that array as an input variable to this for each controller. See, simply remember like this. I have to pass an array to for each controller. It will iterate through all the variables in that. Iterate through all the, you know, occurrences, of, all the values. Right? What does product ID array contain? It contains the product IDs 9, 8, 7, 6, and so on, isn't it? So this is my this is the input variable for this for each controller. Guys, able to follow or no?
Yes, sir. Follow.
It's, you know, bit difficult to remember or a bit difficult. That's why I have kept a screenshot here. See, observe here. I am passing C underscore product ID array, right? I kept a screenshot here. And the next important field is output variable name. For output variable name, what you have to give is you have to give the same variable followed by index. Index is nothing but, you know, like, see, these are called as index. This is index is nothing but, you know, place in the array, right? So these are called as array index. So 1, 10, 11, these are all called as, you know, index. Now, you know, you have to give both these values in the for each controller. One is input variable prefix, which is nothing but your array name. Output variable name should be your, you know, index. What does this return is? It will return this value, guys. Okay, this value, 9, 5, and so on, right? Now, what I have to do is, so this index, right, I have to pass it in the, instead of that number 9 here, right? I have to pass it, you know, like this. Instead of 9, okay, let me do Control Z. Oh, Control Z is not working. Okay, so previously what is there here? You have 9 here, right? I'll do one thing. Okay, here you can see actually. See, you have in the name, it will be there already. So you have to replace that number with this index, okay? Yeah, means nothing but, you know, you are passing that index over here instead of hard-coded value, right? So you have to give that, pass that index. Now let me replay the script and, you know, show you how it works, how for each controller works. So we are done with the script, guys. That's it. Okay, let me replay the script and, you know, let's check whether it is navigating through all the pages or not. So we want to measure the response time of each page, right? So for that, what element we use? If you want to measure the response time of each page.
Summary report.
Yeah, we can add some listeners like, you know, summary report or aggregate report, right? So listeners, some listener like summary report I already added. I'll add aggregate report also. Okay. So let me replay the script now. Let me clear the replay log if there is something there. It is okay. I already cleared it. Let me replay the script and, you know, see how, you know, for each controller works. So if there are any errors, they will show up in the error log, right? It started, the script execution started. Now see the beauty of for each controller. How many, see, this step gets repeated based on how many products are there. As we have 11 products, this step gets repeated 11 times.
Okay.
Right? See how did it get repeated 11 times? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. You can see here in summary report, you can see the samples you get, you know, 11 samples. You can see here also. Right? Browse each laptop, that request is repeated 11 times. Here you can see, right?
Yes, sir.
In summary report or aggregate report, you see the number of samples, right? And you can clearly see here that it got repeated 11 times, isn't it? Home page, laptop space, they are executed once, but this got repeated 11 times. So how is it? How is it happening? Because of this for each, as we used for each controller, what is it doing? What is it doing is, first it will check, you know, what is the size of that array, right? And it will repeat that, you know, that step those many number of times. By every time it will, you know, if you pass this index here, right, in the next step, right, where we have the product ID is getting passed, right? So if you pass the index here, as the array size is 11, right, it repeats that, you know, that request 11 times. Okay. And every time it will change the index value. That's it. So here it will get, you know, like how many times, you know, okay, let me show the debug sampler. Here it got like, you know, match number is 11. So it will repeat the next step 11 times. Every time it changes the index, because how does it change the index? We have to pass that here. Instead of, you know, the product ID hard coded value, we have to pass the index. Then only it will repeat that, you know, it will change the index every time. Means for each, see, the name itself is there, for each controller. Means for each index value, it will repeat the loop. And how many index value we have, how many, you know, what is the array size? Array size is nothing but 11. So for each index value, index, these are the index values, 9, 5, 8, 10, these are index values. So for each index, it will repeat that request. Tomorrow, if they added, you know, suppose now today there are 11 laptops, right? Tomorrow, if they added 5 more laptops, right? 11 plus 5, 16. This loop will be automatically repeated, you know, 16, 15, those many number of times, 16 times, whatever it is. Or if they remove some laptops and, you know, number of laptops is 9, or assume that number of laptops is 8, right? So this loop will be repeated 8 times. You need not bother about that, you know, that for each controller will take care of automatically. Right? So how is for each controller? Is it interesting or, you know, confusing?
Interesting, sir.
Interesting.
Right? So, you know, like, see, 2 months back or 3 months back, I attended one interview, you know, they asked for each controller because the, you know, on their application, you know, their application is something similar to this, right? They have to capture the response times of each page, right? That's why, you know, they want to navigate through all the products. Basically, they want to navigate through all the products. Okay. And, you know, that's why, you know, they use for each controller that, you know, like, so that's, you know, that's why, you know, he stressed on that. Like, you know, he asked more and more questions on this for each controller because they have used it, right? And, you know, you see all the response times of these 11 products. See, average is 1476 milliseconds, which is nothing but 1.5. 476 means almost 1.5 seconds, 1.5 seconds. That is the average response time of each page, isn't it? Maximum is 1.55. Average is 1.47 exactly. Right? If you want to round off, that is 1.5 seconds. Right? Is it clear, guys, how to use for each controller? So if you have any doubt, right, you can refer to this. If you, you know, you can refer to this screenshot. Okay. So I clearly give the, I follow the naming convention. That's why I follow the naming convention. So on seeing the array, you should understand that you have to pass the array name here, right? And, you know, if you want to capture more than one value, you have to use match number as minus one, isn't it? If you use match number as minus one, it will capture all the matchings, all the, you know, occurrences of this left and right boundary, and it will create an array, right? On seeing this, you should remember that, right? And you have to pass the array index as output variable name. In output variable name, you have to pass the array index. And one more thing you have to remember is here, you know, where the product ID is getting passed, right? See, instead of 9, right? So you have to pass this array index. Clear, guys?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Your, you know, your request will be actually like this catalog API. See, actually, it will be like this. Initial ga here it will be, your request will be like this, isn't it? I replaced that 9 with this one, this array, and this one output variable name from the for each controller, this one output variable name. And you have to define this as, I know, you have to give underscore index. You only have to give this. Okay. this variable name, you only have to give this. Got it?
Yes.
Kishore, this is the laptops, so we use index number because it's generating one ID. So in a case, we have Web2 application, right? If you want to do the same thing, how we will know that whether it's an index we are generating or how we will do in Web2's application?
No, in Web2's application, we don't have any such scenario. Have any such scenario. So where this will be useful is like, you know, Flipkart or Amazon kind of applications, right? Where you have some products being displayed and you have to browse through all the products.
Okay.
In such places, you have to use this for each control.
Okay.
See, suppose for example, if you go to, you know, Amazon or Flipkart and search for some product, okay? Suppose I went to Amazon and, you know, I searched for some iPhone, right? Now, you know, you have some products. Now, what the client requirement is something like this. You have to browse through all the pages and see if there are any, you know, issues, right? Browse through all the products. In such cases, we use for each controller. Only in such cases, we use for each controller. Okay. Clear?
Yes.
Client may ask, you know, an interviewer may ask like this, you know, I have some products on my page, right? So I'll show you some other sites where this is not, where this will become, you know, where we have to use this, you know, this one. There are some other sites like, you know, cheapos.com. So, you know, like Sindhu, you might have seen this, you know, this website, right? Cheapos.com, this is a US application.
Yes.
A shopping app. Did you hear this before?
Yeah, yeah. I heard it.
Okay. You didn't use it anytime before?
No, I haven't used it.
Okay. Right. So in such applications, right, such shopping applications, right, you have some, you know, there is one application called Cheapos and, you know, there are few other applications, White Horse Black Market, right? This is one application and Soma is another application. All these kind of shopping applications, right, generally they will have this requirement, right? White Horse Black Market, WHBM, right? White Horse Black Market.com. But these kind of shopping applications where you have a number of products, right? You will use this, you know, you have to use this for each control. Right? What happened to this Flipkart? Right? So once you search for some product, right? So some, you know, LG TV or something, any product, right? You get some search results, right? Now your client requirement is like this. Once you got the search results, you have to navigate through all the pages, right? One by one, right? So in that case, you use this, you know, for each controller. Got it?
Okay.
Yeah. So any queries before? So, you know, like in case you want to refer, right, you know, see, you can access this, the slides from your, you know, phone also, right? If you install Slides app, Google Slides app, you can open the slides on your mobile, from your mobile also. Right? So, you know, like you can refer to this with, you know, like how to use this for each controller in case, you know, like remember this. Okay. So you have to pass two important fields for each controller. The first one is input variable prefix and output variable name. Right. If you can't remember these names, you have to, you know, quickly refer to this. You can quickly refer to this. All right. Okay, I'll stop it here, guys. Any queries before we close the session for today?